a great pleasure of mine to introduce Charles Kesler. Professor Kesler is the Dingler Dykema Professor of Government at Claremont McKenna College out in Southern California. He's known to the world for his very impressive book, I Am the Change, Barack Obama and the Crisis of Liberalism, which was published in 2012. And he's the editor of the Claremont Review of Books, the most important conservative periodical published today. Professor Kesler is a Harvard man. He has his PhD and undergraduate degree from Harvard. To me, Professor Kesler is my teacher. My fondest memories of college were actually sitting with Father Legge in Professor Kessler's classes. A teacher, a mentor, a dissertation advisor, and now a good friend. It's my pleasure to introduce to you Charles Kesler.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure to be here today, especially in the company of old friends and students of mine, like Phil Munoz, who's now tenured at Notre Dame and the head of the Tocqueville Center there, as you have already heard, and Father Legge from the Thomistic Institute. It's intimidating to appear before these wise young men who have done so much already in their short lives and who have succeeded in taking us all back to the Middle Ages with admirable insight and expertness, and I'm grateful to them for that. I thought that was a magnificent discussion of Thomas Aquinas, really first rate, and I learned a lot from it. So thank you, Father Legge, for that. But let me take us briefly from the Middle Ages back to America. On his way from Springfield to his inauguration in Washington, D.C., Abraham Lincoln paused for a series of impromptu speeches, including one at Independence Hall in Philadelphia on February 22nd, 1861. He said there, quote, "I am filled with deep emotion at finding myself standing here in the place where were collected together the wisdom, the patriotism, the devotion to principle, from which sprang the institutions under which we live. I can say," he continued, "that all the political sentiments I entertain have been drawn, so far as I've been able to draw them, from the sentiments which originated and were given to the world from this hall, Independence Hall in Philadelphia." While seeming to speak of, by reference to the institutions of America, while seeming to speak of the Constitution, Lincoln really had all along been speaking also of the Declaration of Independence, the most fundamental of American institutions in the old sense of the term, institutio, meaning education. He confirmed that to great cheering in his next climactic sentence. "I have never had a feeling politically," he said, "that did not spring from the sentiments embodied in the Declaration of Independence." One might almost say the same thing about American democracy itself, that all its political feelings somehow spring from the sentiments embodied in the Declaration of Independence. Ordinary Americans, even today, know or have a feel for the Declaration better than they do for the Constitution. Nothing is more common than to see, quote, "all men are created equal," unquote, being attributed to or identified with the Constitution, which in a deep sense, it is, although in a more accurate sense, it is not. American citizens have deep-seated attachments to the Declaration that they don't quite have for the Constitution, except insofar as they commit this patriotic mistake of confusing the two. Though our countrymen may be bad historians, they are good political scientists. The political sentiments of the Declaration constitute us as a people in a more fundamental way than the Constitution does. Some confirmation of this comes from the fact that in most periods of intense political change, and in almost every instance of dramatic and enduring political realignment, the Declaration of Independence emerges as a touchstone of the debate. Each side typically wants to claim it as peculiarly its own, to associate the Declaration with its own political sentiments. At its height, American political history is a kind of running battle over the interpretation of the Declaration, over its original meaning and its meaning under present, i.e. new, circumstances. We can see this even in our own day. Now, no president has quoted more frequently the Declaration of Independence in modern life than Barack Obama. It forms the chief text of his second inaugural, but it has been an important part of many of his speeches. And I would say every one of the times that he essays to mention the Declaration of Independence, he is engaged in an interpretation of the Declaration of Independence, one whose political goal is certainly to establish its harmony with his own policies and his own sentiments, so as to make clear that if the founders were around today, they would have voted for him. And that is not, this is something in a way that Lincoln himself did, FDR did, Barack Obama has tried to do. It is a hallmark of intense political conflict in our country because it is an attempt to go back to the beginnings, to ground the authority of the present generation in the continuing and original authority that established the nation. So what I would like to do today is talk a little bit about the Declaration of Independence, not so much specifically, although I will talk about it specifically, but as a symbol of America's moral understanding at a very deep level. And I want to raise concerning that understanding these questions about natural rights and the status of natural rights and the meaning of natural rights that we have already seen explored so well in connection with the Catholic tradition and in particular with the Catholic tradition of the early Middle Ages, not only in its Thomistic variant, although that is of course one of the glories of it, but in several other of its variants. If you just look at the Declaration, or if you look at the scholarship, modern scholarship that has grown up around it, you would see that the Declaration is a house of many mansions. It has been argued that it is a doctrine, that it is a document of natural right and the social compact, that it is a document of Christian republicanism, that it is an instance of classical prudence, that it represents the well-worn channels of British constitutionalism, and even more recently that it is an emblem of the law of nations or of a certain kind of allegiance to international law. These are at least five schools of interpretation that have grown up around the Declaration of Independence. One traces it back, you could say, to the liberalism of John Locke or something like that. And this is an interpretation that everyone from discontented progressives 100 years ago to contemporary Straussian scholars and others have made. At the same time, there seems to be an unending book, series of books on the founders as Christian believers and Christian statesmen of one kind or another, and it is certainly true that God in various aspects is mentioned four times in the Declaration of Independence. And not simply as the creator, but in some simply deistic sense, but God is mentioned as a lawgiver, the laws of nature and of nature's God. He is mentioned as divine providence, that is presumably a God who intervenes to favor the just and to punish the unjust in human affairs. And he's introduced as the supreme judge of the world. So although normal human beings cannot violate separation of powers without being tyrants, God can. He's a lawgiver, he's an executive, and he's a judge, all the while also being a creator God. Then there is, as I say, a school of scholarship that has grown up around the so-called classical Republican thesis, Gordon Wood, J.G.A. Pocock, and others. There is a long-standing school that looks to the Declaration as an Anglo-American document. Russell Kirk, Daniel Boorstin, some of the names you would think of in this school, and more recently, Samuel Huntington, the late Samuel Huntington, in his last book, Who Are We?, a book about national identity in America, he placed himself firmly on the side of the position that America is, in its essence, what he called an Anglo-Protestant nation. And finally, as I mentioned, and I'll just briefly mention it again, there is the view that in the Declaration of Independence you see the unprecedented influence of a new kind of international law, or the law of nations. David Armitage has a book about this, and many other books are sure to follow. Now, I think there's some truth to each of these interpretations. As an appeal to mankind and for foreign recognition and support, the Declaration partook of the law of nations. The long indictment of George III, in the middle of the document, accuses the king of being a tyrant and instances his violation of America's Constitution, a word written with a small c, meaning America's view of their position in the British Constitution, this quartering troops without permission, taxes without representation, and so forth. And certainly there is a long tradition of the Christian or Protestant interpretation of the Declaration, I mean, in ways going back before the Declaration, maybe, to Milton and his Protestant, his version of sort of Protestant and classical republicanism. But of course, it is the inalienable rights doctrine and the social compact that dominate, I would say, the Declaration's logic of resistance, revolution, and independence. The United States was the first country in human history to be founded so explicitly on the theory of the social compact. In many ways, the U.S. is still the only country in the world whose national identity and civic purpose rest squarely on this doctrine. In most countries, citizenship as a formal and still more as an informal or cultural matter depends on shared ethnicity, kinship, language, often religion, not on the free consent of individuals. But the world has moved more and more in the direction of the American doctrine of social compact. You can see this in the simple fact that there are now something like almost 100 countries around the world that have declarations of independence. America invented not just a doctrine and a document for itself, but a genre that many states have now adopted, especially after World War II, as the great European colonial empires began to unwind, and more states had felt the necessity to declare their independence in some formal way. So if we look at the Declaration, first of all, in that light, as a doctrine, as a document of the natural rights argument, as a document of the social compact position, we see that, you might say, the social compact is an inference from the principle that all men are created equal. I will not be the first, however, to point out that the peculiar statement of natural rights and social compact in our Declaration deserves attention. The Americans, in their formal statement about what they were going to do and its justification begin with a statement about truth. We hold these truths to be self-evident. So far from trying to ground rights or contract or consent in something, in a subjective doctrine, subjective here not quite in the sense we've been talking about it before, but in the sense of moral relativity or perspectivalism, the Declaration goes as far to the other side of that scale as possible. It grounds what follows in what it asserts to be true, and not only true, but self-evidently true, the most obvious kind, the most irrefutable kind of truth. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. Created equal. Before rights, before liberty even, the Declaration puts the emphasis on that ontological fact. What we are stems from our creation as equals, as equal human beings. It is from that creation, which takes the peculiar shape of an endowment. All men are created equal, endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, among which are life, liberty, and property. Our freedom, our rights, comes from the fact that we are equal, that we are equally human beings, that each one of us has the same authority as any other human being. No one of us has more natural authority over another than that other has over us. In that sense, since we are equal, we are free of each other's natural political authority. It's because we are equally created as humans that we have a right to be free of one another, a right not to be owned by one another. Because no one of us is like a human being to a horse, or to an inferior species, where you could infer a certain right of ownership from the inequality between the horse species and the human species. Among humans, there is no such categorical inequality, and hence no basis for a natural right to rule without consent over equal human beings. Our rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, among others, spring from our quality, our equality as human beings. This state of natural equality is therefore also a state of natural liberty. From such a condition, political society arises only by mutual consent and in two stages. First, by unanimous consent to form a people or a society, and second, by majority consent to entrust a particular form of government with authority over the people that has just created itself. To secure these rights, governments are instituted among men. That expression was put in the passive, I think, quite deliberately. It implies that men institute government over themselves, but by putting it in the passive, you leave open the possibility that God is the institutor of government, though every particular government is instituted by men. But government itself is a divine institution. That, at least, that reading, which is certainly a legitimate Christian reading on that subject, is made possible or compatible with the Declaration by casting that famous assertion in the passive. But at any rate, to secure these rights, we have to do something. We have to rule ourselves. We have to institute governments and, you know, arranging their principles and their powers in such a way as will secure our safety and happiness. So what began in this long sentence, or a couple of sentences, depending on how you'd like to punctuate it. What began as individual rights grounded in truth turns in the end to objects of action, to ends of action, safety and happiness, which the people themselves are responsible for securing to themselves. So you could say justice, from the Declaration's point of view, is not only about the individual use, to use Father Legge's formulation, our rights, but also about how we use them to govern ourselves. An endowment is not the same thing as a general grant. An endowment is a gift for a particular purpose. When God endows us with rights, he intends us to use them wisely to secure our safety and our happiness. In that sense, you could say there's a kind of teleological necessity, there's a kind of old-fashioned moral logic to the admittedly new-fashioned doctrine of individual rights that the Declaration has just displayed to us. In a nutshell, that's its account of the social compact. The Declaration, you notice, doesn't mention the state of nature, nor does it derive men's passions from any men's rights from any anterior passion, like the right, like the desire for self-preservation in John Locke, or even the desire to accumulate property, as in Hobbes, first, and then John Locke. The Declaration insists on looking at rights as part of a divine and natural endowment, or to put it differently, looking at rights in the light of the high, the ends of human nature, and not simply in the light of the low, the needs, the desire for self-preservation, the desire to advantage oneself, or to accumulate property and other kinds of safeguards for one's life. Now, let me say something about this doctrine in the context of Christianity, since this has come up as with Patrick Deneen's and others' views on this question today. It is often said in histories of political philosophy that social compact theory of this sort, especially in its Hobbesian or Spinozist form, is anti-Christian. Anti-Christian in effect, if not in intention, and often it is said in both. The state of nature, the argument goes, replaces the Garden of Eden. Man's beginnings no longer are perfect and completely provided for by God, but are radically necessitous, exposing us to the constant danger of death and invasion by other human beings. We're radically on our own in our beginnings. We owe nothing to God, or almost nothing to God, or to nature. And so the argument goes, sovereignty in the form of the modern secular state is necessary to replace God's grace as the necessary and sufficient condition for human happiness. We have to get ourselves out of the state of nature by an act, a daring act of human imagination and human creativity, which owes very little to God. It's our salvation lies not in heaven, but in heaven on earth, or the transformation of earth that man alone can bring about through his labor and his will. As I say, this is a very common interpretation of America, common interpretation of modern Lockean sort of consent theory. But this isn't how the Americans understood their own social contract doctrine. If you read John Adams, if you read the sermons of very many Protestant and Catholic ministers in the period of the American Revolution before and after, the American Revolution, you'll find a very different understanding of what it is they're trying to accomplish. Adams, John Adams in particular, but many other Americans, thought in a way that social compact theory of this sort was necessary to save Christianity from itself. Christianity was, of course, no longer Catholicism exclusively. The Protestant Reformation had rent Christianity into many contending pieces, had led to a kind of holocaust of wars and savage religious repression across Europe for more than a century. The Americans did not want that holocaust, as it were, to continue in America. And so they had to, in a way, they were looking for a solution to the problem of disorder within Christendom, within the Christian world. As you know, I'll put this long story in as short a way as I can. The Catholic teaching on the subject is often referred to as the teaching of the two swords. That is, that God gives one sword to the civil government, to the secular powers, but he gives another sword to the church to enforce religious discipline and to provide for the salvation of souls. The fact that there are two swords and two potentially coercive powers led to a long period of disorder in Western Christendom and of conflict between the Pope's authority and the authority of national, secular emperors and a few republican regimes. When Protestantism entered the scene, Luther attempted to replace the doctrine of the two kingdoms with the doctrine of the two swords, that's the Catholic doctrine, with what he called the doctrine of the two kingdoms, the kingdom of God and the kingdom of this world. The kingdom of God was the church, and of course perfected in heaven, but the kingdom of this world is everything else. And what is most striking about Luther's formulation is that there's only one sword. The kingdom of God does not get a sword. The church does not get coercive power in secular affairs or in worldly affairs. The only sword is given to the world, that is, to the secular government. And the aim of this was not only to perfect the church and to liberate the church from worldly corruptions and the temptations of political power, but it was also to produce peace in the world by reducing the conflict between armed authorities. Neither of those lofty goals, of course, was actually realized. And what Adams and other Americans, mostly Protestants, but not entirely, were looking for was found in the doctrine of the social contract, they thought, was a way to discover a new basis for political authority that would be immune to the conflicts that had rent Christendom for so long. And they did this in two stages. First, by discovering a new basis for political membership in the consent of the governed, and second, by distinguishing church membership, now a voluntary act guided by consent, from political membership or citizens. So, from the Americans' point of view, if Locke didn't exist, he'd have to have been invented, because Locke was necessary to save Luther, or to relieve Luther of the fatal contradictions that he had inflicted upon the world in the Protestant Reformation and its aftermath. Social compact theory thus found a ready home among the Puritan divines of New England and the Anglicans and Baptists of the South, because far from abolishing Christianity, in their view, it saved it by restoring it to its non-persecuting purity, as exemplified by Christ and his disciples and the earliest church. For many Americans, including American Catholics, social compact theory allowed the United States to enjoy the purest Christianity, least persecuting, least corrupted by worldly temptations and political temptations, the freest doctrinally, and utterly open to competition among preachers over the purity of their morals and the theoretical adequacy of their views of salvation. In this sense, from the point of view of many Americans, what the founding was about, in the broadest sense of the founding now, including things going on in the states and for the next generation or so at least to come, was restoring a Christian world, a peaceful Christian world in which the dignity of human nature and the freedom of human nature had been made compatible for the first time in many centuries with religious toleration and with civil government. Now, as if that weren't enough, let me say something else, not just about the issue of Christianity as they saw it, but let me say something about nature, human nature, in the understanding of the Americans at the time. What was the ground and meaning of man's natural equality as they saw it? Well, again, if we look at this from a certain textbook point of view, it looks eminently suspicious. For Spinoza, man was not, as he famously said, a kingdom within a kingdom. Man was like every other kind of being. Each of us was involved in a kind of relentless pursuit of power for the sake of survival. Fortunately, man was well off because of man's intelligence. We had an advantage over the other species. But in effect, we were not ultimately different in kind from the other species. Each of us was about survival and, to the extent possible, living after our own mind or living after our own opinions or according to our own priorities. For Thomas Hobbes, man was more distinctive but more isolated, living by nature, as you all know, a solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short existence. But if you look at many Americans of the period, and especially the more famous Americans of the period, you find, for example, among Alexander Hamilton and James Wilson, explicit attacks on Hobbes for his materialism and atheism. And many founders, among them Adams again and Wilson and Thomas Jefferson, explicitly also part company with Thomas Hobbes and to a degree even Locke on the issue of man's sociality and morality. It is actually very hard to find any American founder who doesn't believe that man is naturally social, which is from at least a plain reading of Locke, a rather heretical principle. Human nature, man may in some sense have something to do with a state of nature, but it's not actually his natural state. By nature, man is meant to live with other human beings, and he has a kind of natural moral sense or natural conscience to guide him, given to him by nature, so that he may live in with others according to nature. the first principles or sentiments that help guide us to live well and peacefully and humanely with our fellow human beings are very far removed, therefore, from Hobbesian fear of the other or from Lockean calculation. But if man is born for society and even for a certain kind of benevolence, what's he doing in the state of nature? Well, I will give you a very short answer on this question. And funnily enough, Rousseau had his finger on the problem, which he claimed was implicit in the very arguments of Hobbes and Locke, and particularly their portraits of the state of nature. In the second discourse, Rousseau accused these early social contract thinkers of not going back far enough in their quest to find natural man, man in the state of nature. As described by Hobbes and Locke, the individual in the state of nature is, Rousseau said, much too advanced, much too reasonable. He would almost have to have been a philosopher to imagine and then to create his way out of the state of nature that leads into civil society. Rousseau famously argued that unless man in the natural state is not only pre-political but pre-rational, the attempt to locate human nature prior to civil society must fail. By pre-rational, that means if man didn't begin as something pre-human, not a rational animal, but he must have begun as something, if he's pre-social, he must also be pre-rational. And so you could say the beginnings of Darwin's theory of evolution are contained in the seeds of Rousseau's second discourse. Man must have begun as a very different animal than he is today, or than we have ever seen him in human history. Therefore, Rousseau said, the state of nature of Hobbes and Locke is a fiction. It could not be real. The state of nature is simply modern society stripped of a few of its accoutrements. And they think by doing that, they discover human nature. But no, they really only discover Englishmen and Frenchmen with the government removed for a moment. The whole attempt to discover the nature of man by going backwards before society had failed because Hobbes and Locke had imported some teleological element into their picture of man. If you look at man in the state of nature, he's really man ready for civil society, eager to get to civil society, eager to get out of the state of nature. He's not at home in the state of nature. He wants to get out of there as fast as he can. And that's because he already has a kind of purpose, an end, which is partly self-preservation, but it's also living in peace with others like himself. I mean, his natural sociality, his natural humanity helped to attract him easily out of the state of nature. So, in effect, Hobbes and Locke had smuggled in a hidden or implicit teleology into their account of man. Who wants to escape the state of nature as soon as possible because he's not at home there. He's at home in civil society. He wants to get back to where he, in a sense, began and where he belongs. The individual in the state of nature was still a man meant to live in civil society. In short, the Americans agreed with Rousseau's critique but drew, I would say, the opposite conclusion from it. They admit, in effect, the Americans do, that there is an implicit teleology in the Lockean account of the state of nature. Rational man does imply something like political man or social man. So an unbridgeable gap between the ancients and moderns didn't exist insofar as, if you want to call this modern political philosophy, can be interpreted in a very old-fashioned way or teleologically. From the point of view of political practice, this assimilation of ancients or Christians to the social contract doctrine was in a way natural. It was the only way to make sense of the republican liberalism of Locke and others. So I would assert that as statesmen, the founders never doubted for a moment that the human beings were a species in nature distinct from and superior to other animals, nor did they doubt the self-evident truth that all men are created equal could be the foundation of just government, precisely because it recognized the differences between man and beast on the one hand, and the differences between man and the creator on the other. So, for most of the founders, the state of nature features men in the company of family and friends, all regulated by a natural moral law that did not take a back seat to natural rights. The state of nature showed man to be in need of and fit for political governance, and it served to show how that governance could be derived and limited. Tom Paine makes these points very clearly in the famous opening paragraphs of Common Sense. He says there famously that men have confused society with government. And he says, society is a product of our wants, government of our wickedness. And society is natural to man and fulfills human nature in a way that government does not. Government, he says, even in the best of conditions, is always a necessary evil. Society is always something good and naturally good. Now, that is not the same as Aristotle, but it is something a lot closer to Aristotle than Hobbes or Locke's state of nature. And it is much closer also, I think, to the American consensus on the question. For most Americans, human nature as revealed in the state of nature is compatible with and illuminated by the accounts in classical and Christian authorities. For the Americans, cowardice is not rational. This is one of Hobbes's famous statements. If there's a right to life, you've got to be stupid to risk your life, as a courageous man would, because you're risking the most valuable thing. Why would you risk your life? Let somebody else risk their life. That's Hobbes's version of courage. Courage is irrational for him, strictly speaking, which is why you don't want to be courageous, but you perhaps want somebody else to be courageous for you. But for Americans, that's not true. Cowardice is not irrational, and honor is not merely the reputation of power. Honor was or could be sacred. Let me close by invoking Thomas Jefferson's famous letter to Henry Lee, May the 8th, 1825. Jefferson is a very old man, just a year or so from the time he would die. He had been invited to come to Washington, D.C. to celebrate the upcoming 50th anniversary of the Declaration of Independence. He was too ill to go, but he sent a letter to be read at the celebration that was upcoming. And in the letter, he famously said, we used to think, by the way, that this was Jefferson's last letter, which gave it a certain wonderful cachet. Scholars have since discovered it was not his last letter. There are a couple of letters to his wine merchant, you know. So it's okay. Very Jeffersonian, you know. But anyway, he says famously, with respect to our rights, he said, all American Whigs thought alike on these subjects. The Declaration of Independence was intended to be an expression of the American mind, and to give expression, to give that expression the proper tone and spirit called for by the occasion. All its authority, then, rests on the harmonizing sentiments of the day, whether expressed in conversation, in letters, printed essays, or in the elementary books of public right, as Aristotle, Cicero, Locke, Sidney, etc. Now, this promiscuous mixture of ancients and moderns, Aristotle, Cicero, Locke, Algernon Sidney, another British Republican, famous martyr to the cause, don't easily keep house together according to the usual histories of political ideas. And yet here they are. This is by no means an unrepresentative assertion by an American about the sources, you might say, of the public doctrines of right, including natural rights, in the American founding. What does this mixture tell us, finally? Aristotle, Cicero, Locke, Sidney. The Declaration signers did not represent Spartans or an American people who wanted to become Spartans, and that sort of thoroughgoing classical republicanism is obviously not to be found in the Declaration. But what is present is a kind of classical rationalism of prudence and philosophical realism. And the choice, as indicated in Jefferson's letter, for a broadly defined republican government. Aristotle, Cicero, Locke, and Sidney could all be taken as republican writers, that is, as writers in defense of the public's right to rule itself, as over against the right of an absolute monarch or a tyrant to rule them in his own name. The Americans represent, it seems to me, a kind of return to common sense, to the common sense presuppositions of philosophical realism, wondrous way, which adapting the traditions of moral inquiry to the needs and circumstances of their own situation in America, they in effect add a chapter to the tradition of disputation and understanding that we were discussing earlier today in the 16th century and the 14th century and the 13th century and the 12th century. They saw themselves as broadly participating in the same conversation, I would say, and in the same attempt to establish non-tyrannical government with the consent of the governed themselves, with the consent of the people themselves. In so doing, they recognized natural rights and natural duties, that the two of them went together, that the two of them advanced, in the best of cases, the safety and the happiness of their society. Thank you very much.
Okay, we have a bit of time for questions. And once again, I'd like to ask the questioners if you stand up so we can see you and hear you and identify yourself. Please, sir.
Hello, my name is Jorge, and I have a question. Does the Catholic Church still hold the doctrine of two sources, the government and the church? Or did it change?
That's a good question, to which I think the answer is no. But I should defer to someone who knows more about contemporary church doctrine than I. I mean, the church has, after all, incorporated, I mean, in the course of the 20th century, it incorporated a doctrine of human rights, indeed of natural rights, into its self-understanding, and it altered some of its historical positions on the relation between church and state in keeping with that new understanding of rights. American Catholics were by and large in the same position the church found itself in 200 years earlier, and made, you could say, adapted and adopted those principles very early in American history, and fairly easily in American history, in fact.
Charles, would you indulge a brief comment?
Yes, sure, yes. If you know more than I do, which is very likely. I think
it's important to say, the Catholic Church, philosophers use the word doctrine to mean generally teaching. Catholics use it very technical sense, to mean an express official teaching of the Church. So the teaching or the theory of the two swords was not a doctrine or dogma of the Church. It was a prominent theological motif. It was a common theory held by many. And in fact, I think, for the sake of argument, one can hold that one might still hold it. I don't think that it's reprobated. There have been a series of enunciations by the Church that are about things like the right to religious freedom or the rights of states to ensure the common good in modernity that women would have to take account of. But there's never been sort of like one universal dogma of church-state relations. On the contrary, the Church tends to be pretty flexible, and I think it's important just to realize also the Church does still have concordats with Catholic states, where there are agreements about the ways that Catholic states will uphold their half of a constitutional agreement to represent the Catholic Church in a public way. And that's a very alien idea for us in the United States today, but it's certainly still very prominent in the wider world.
One could also say that from that marvelous quadlibet that Father Legg adduced earlier in the afternoon, that one could see how rich the Catholic tradition is on the question and how nuanced it could be in treating, actually in concrete cases, the relation between the Church and secular governments. It was not, I mean, unfortunately, it probably was not always as nuanced as Thomas Aquinas might have liked it to be.
One more question. You quoted Rousseau, the state of nature of love and hopes is not...
Yes. Oh, well, it's not... his point was this was in the so-called second discourse on the origins of inequality, which is a famous prize-winning essay of Rousseau's. He makes this criticism of his predecessors, Hobbes and Locke, in the social contract tradition. And he says that their efforts to find human nature, to find natural man, before society had failed utterly, because they didn't go back far enough.
So it's just to say that the state of nature of love and hopes is not natural.
That's right. No, he thought. I mean, from his point of view, the state of nature that Locke describes sounds very much like England. You know, with the police and the army on leave, and not in the field. It's a very civilized place, at least in the beginning. That state, Locke's state of nature, and it's because it's meant to really turn into civil society.
Chicago.
Like that? Yes, right.
I'd like to put some of the Thomas in conversation. So. The last two presentations both have defended natural rights in a certain way. I'm wondering if they're as compatible as they might seem. Professor Kesler focused on equality as sort of the foundation of the founders' natural rights, as a relation among men of one equality. Where would a question really for the Thomas to comment on does equality and this natural political equality, is that compatible with Thomas's political thought?
Yeah, yes, I think so. I mean, Father White is looking skeptical over there.
No, I feel like it's, I suppose I have doctrinal allergy sensitivities. I think it is important in this context to recall that Gaudium et Spes teaches that there is in some respect, a fundamental moral equality that obtains among all people. So. Whatever a Thomist might say, the Catholic Church has affirmed some kind of fundamental equality. And then I have ideas as a Thomist about how to handle that, but I think Father Legge...
Equality in what?
Well, Father Legge, why don't you go ahead
and... Well, I think for Aquinas, what is... So you could talk about who can have a use, who can have a right And
of course,
an animal can't, but a human being can. And why? It's because of the rational nature. It's that, if you go back to that quadrilateral question, there's actually, I didn't include the whole excerpt, where Aquinas is talking about how you can have rights over an animal,
mm-hmm.
like you can use
right.
an animal,
right.
And abuse, not abuse, but you can even consume. I mean, literally, we do that. You can consume an animal. But you can't do that with a child. Nonetheless, a child who has not attained the age of reason can be directed because he or she can't yet direct himself. And that's why that line that I did quote about when you reach the age of reason, you begin to possess yourself
mm-hmm.
is so significant, because at that point, you are capable of ordering yourself to God, and that is the most important sort of thing that you could ever do. And so I think you could build a case for fundamental human equality from precisely that. And that's something that no positive authority could ever supersede.
I mean, you can't, to have any natural law doctrine, or at least to have the Catholic natural law doctrine, you have to have human equality. I mean, every human being is subject to natural law. Natural law is defined as the rational creature's participation in the eternal law. It's a species jurisdiction. Cats and dogs don't participate in natural law. Humans can. And they participate by virtue of their rationality, or you could say by virtue of having the divine image stamped upon them. But from Thomas's point of view, that's the same thing. But that would require a longer argument. But I think in effect, it is the same thing.
Let's get a couple more questions from that.
We're talking about the founding fathers' inequality. How do you reconcile their philosophical outlook on life with the fact that back then there was extreme inequality with slavery and with men and women, yet they're the ones setting the precedent for our country now?
Well, of course, this is an important question. But in general, I like Bernard Bailyn's line as a quick way of answering this question or beginning, you know, of the process of a longer answer. He used to say that it is certainly true that the American Revolution did not solve the problem of slavery. But what the American Revolution did was to create the problem of slavery, because it in a republic dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal, slavery could no longer be considered as a trivial matter of social utility or as an inheritance from the past which could not be questioned or superseded. It became eventually imperative for the whole country to face the question of slavery, because the country had committed itself to the proposition that all men are created equal. If it had not so committed itself, slavery would not have been the urgent and in a way the decisive moral political issue that it became.
Do you see that then as an underlying point of most political discussions today in terms of equality and religion and gender and minorities? Like, do you think that that's an underpinning of a lot of the discussions that we're having in politics?
Well, this comes back in a way to this some of the questions that were asked at the end of last period. I don't think that the agenda of equality today is necessarily an implication of the understanding of equality from the founding. Slavery and to some extent many other issues, including women's suffrage, I think are legitimate applications of the founders' principle. I think it's more correct to say that democracies democratize, and a regime committed to a certain kind of equality feels a great deal of political pressure to expand that kind of equality and to apply it to circumstances which are quite different, and in some way, to some degree, perhaps even contradictory to the moral impulse that defined the original form of human equality. But this is really a question of politics, I would say. You know, every regime has a certain tendency, and oligarchies tend to become more oligarchical, democracies tend to become more democratic. And that's the direction, the natural direction that their politics moves in and is drawn towards. So it shouldn't surprise us part of our politics has been responding to new demands for equality from new groups that have been either excluded or overlooked in the previous political structure of the country.
Why don't we take one more question?
Yeah, to what extent in assessing traditions of political thought, certainly the tradition of natural rights originating in the Declaration, to what extent do you think we should take success or positive outcome as a factor, particularly in light of widespread consensus these days that our political situation is not ideal?
Well, success, the fact of success has a certain political weight, but doesn't necessarily have a moral weight. I mean, you know, Churchill is famous for saying, it's not possible to guarantee success. It's only possible to deserve, to guarantee that you deserve success. You know, the good guys can lose in politics. Good countries can lose their wars sometimes. Victory for the right forces is not guaranteed. So yes, there's a famous essay by Martin Irving Kristol called "The American Revolution as a Successful Revolution," which is devoted to this question, celebrating the success of the American Revolution versus the failure of the French. And that contrast, of course, between the bloodiness and disaster of the French Revolution coming so soon after the American Revolution and the peacefulness and general success of the American Revolution. That contrast has been a very striking one for a very long time and almost impossible not to observe. But having said that, I mean, success, pure and simple, doesn't mean that you deserve that success. That has to be justified on the merits of a country or of a political experiment. Still, you know, from a common sense point of view and from an Aristotelian point of view, success does have some weight, does have some meaning in politics. If success doesn't necessarily guarantee morality, neither does failure, and success in general is better than failure, if you're a halfway decent country, at least.
We have one remaining panel, which is meant to have a conversation about all the presentations of the day. We'll start that at 5 o'clock, so we'll just have a short break. Before we go to break, please join me in thanking Professor Kesler.